me.
Oh shit, what's up everybody? It's me, Drew, and welcome to Social Distance Cinema Discussion. This week we watched the 2010 film, The King's Speech. Biopics have a tendency to stretch the truth a little bit to tell a more dramatic narrative. That's kind of a good thing, because without it, biopics would just be filled with moments like this. Person's life can be pretty boring, so it's helpful to hone in on a select few elements and have a clear obstacle for the protagonist to overcome. Framing a story in this way is mostly harmless, so long as you don't mislead the audience or mischaracterize historical events or figures for insidious reasons. If now you're worried about the historical accuracy of The King's Speech, don't be, because over the past few days, I've spent far too much time learning about King George VI and stammering, so you don't have to. Sure, there's a whole section of the King's Speech's Wikipedia page dedicated to its historical accuracy. But isn't it more fun to hear it in a video format from me, a guy that until yesterday knew absolutely nothing about the British royal family? Society is doomed. Prince Albert, or as his family called him, Bertie, was born in 1895 and reigned as King of Britain from 1936 to 1952. You'll be relieved to find out that Bertie did in fact have a stammer. As relieved as someone can be when finding out that someone has a debilitating speech impediment, the aspect of this film that's most played up for dramatic effect is Lionel and Bertie's relationship. Their interaction was based primarily on letters that were written between the two. From the letters, it was clear that there was a certain familiarity and wit between the two, although Lionel's grandson has publicly stated that there was no way that they were on a first-name basis.
How about Bertie? Only my family used to say.
That's all right, though. Who cares? As is written in the film, Lionel Logue was, in fact, an Australian that worked with shell-shocked World War I victims who had developed impaired speech. Sorry, ladies, but Bertie's wife, Elizabeth, did not introduce the two. They were introduced by some random dude named Lord Stamfordham, who, among other things, was known for his cool mustache. I made that up.
You know, I refused your first two marriage proposals, not because I didn't love you, but because I couldn't bear the idea of
As the film states, Elizabeth did, in fact, refuse to marry Bertie twice because she had no interest in becoming a royal family member, but she was monumental in his life and was a huge proponent of modernization. Overall, this change fits both the historical figure and her character in the film, so I see it as a beneficial change. Honestly, kind of a sausage fest anyway. Lionel never took notes on their sessions, so most of the unorthodox therapies you see on screen are taken directly from the personal experience of David Seidler, the screenwriter. David Seidler was the perfect person to tell the story because he grew up in that time period with a stutter, and King George VI was his biggest hero. Bertie's confession to Lionel about his childhood abuse is also largely accurate. Prince Albert just had the shittiest young life ever. Royal parenting wasn't really a thing back then, so he and his brother spent most of their time with nannies. The abusive nanny, whose name has never been released, mainly targeted Albert because she knew his brother would eventually become the king. She did in fact starve him for, let's see here, 3 years! Only after that ridiculously long period of time did his parents finally realize how skinny he was looking. As the film says, he was also trained out of his left-handedness. This was common practice at the time because most people are right-handed, and if you have a left hand, then clearly you're a rebellious person. God, the 1900s sucked. Bertie also says he wore leg braces for knocked knees. Knocked knees are just when your knees point inward instead of forward. Up until the age of 8, that's a normal stage of child development, and they gave him leg braces at 4. Nice people. There's no general consensus on what causes stuttering or stammering, which are words that are used interchangeably. Most people believe it to be a combination of different factors, including genetics and stress. Research into the royal family history of stutterers came up mostly dry, so that's kind of a dead end. In the film, Lionel points out that stuttering is common with people who have undergone left-handed corrections.
Are you naturally right-handed? Yeah. I was punished and now I use the right. Yes, that's very common with stammerers.
During the time this takes place, research linked those two ideas quite closely. It was thought that weakening the right hemisphere of your brain resulted in neither hemisphere being dominant. Some studies were conducted in which people who underwent left-handed corrections and stuttered switched back to their right hand. According to the researchers, it was an overwhelming success, which strengthened this idea. As time went on, the importance of left-handed corrections and stuttering took a back seat. A study conducted in the great state of New Jersey determined that the corrections themselves weren't the problem, but the harsh methodology used in the corrections were. Seeing as the nanny abuse coincided with the left-handed corrections, seems like a recipe for disaster. There's a number of tips online that tell you how to support a stutterer in your family, and when looking at one of the scenes in this movie, it's clear to see why he had so many issues. First tip is to be patient and try not to finish what the other person is saying.
Marvels of modern.
The second tip is to try to get the person to relax. Any added pressure will just make it worse.
Wireless. Get him out, boy.
And the third tip is to speak calmly or a little slower than normal.
Just try it.
Do it.
Nowadays, we know that stuttering occurs more frequently in brains with a dominant right hemisphere. And left-handed people have a dominant right hemisphere. Even though left-handed corrections haven't been proven to cause stuttering, I'd recommend against it. There doesn't seem to be any real benefit. There's some other really cool attention to detail things that I'll point out now.
I had a speech impediment myself, you know. I didn't.
At a young age, Winston Churchill was, in fact, a stutterer, but he wasn't the biggest fan of Bertie.
Please don't do that.
I'm sorry.
I believe sucking smoke into your lungs will kill you.
There's some dramatic irony in Lionel refusing to allow Bertie to smoke because Bertie died of smoking-related issues.
You still stammered on the W.
I had to throw in a few. So then it was me.
This is an actual line from one of their letters, and it was used as the backbone for the wit in their relationship.
I have found it impossible to believe that there is any man in the world so lacking in moral feeling as Hitler.
Hitler was, in fact, a big old bully bitch. Overall, the King's Speech is a very responsible depiction of history. It doesn't endanger the message or the seriousness of the time period. I give The King's Speech 14 out of 15 lobsters. If you like this movie, then I encourage you to watch the director Tom Hooper's most recent film, Cats. No, I'm not joking. What did you think of The King's Speech? Is it okay to stretch the truth a little bit for historical pieces? Let me know in the comments section. And while you're down there, give me a like and a subscribe, you left-handed son of a bitch. If you have a movie or a film genre that you'd like to recommend, let me know in the comments section, the Discord, or the movie list that can be found on the Discord. And as always, stay safe, stay healthy, and hopefully I'll see you next week.